بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا. Welcome everybody, inshallah. Jazakum Allah khair for your attendance. We hope to do this course Zad al-Mustaqnia. It's going to be focusing on the book pertaining to purification for the next 15 weeks or so, inshallah. As we know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man yuridillahu bihi khair yufaqihu fi din." That whoever Allah wants to give him good, then he will give him fiqh, understanding of the religion. And the Prophet ﷺ said, "Man salaka tariqan yaltamisu fihi ilm, sahala Allahu lahu tariq ila jannah." That whoever takes a path therein to seek knowledge, then Allah will make his path for him easy to Jannah. So something, this time that you have given up, I know it's hard after work, etc., but the reward for it is immense. And that's what you have to keep in mind, especially when studying fiqh. Because when studying fiqh, you'll find that it's not like going to a lecture where your iman gets boosted. For some of us, yes, we really enjoy the study of the fiqh. For others, you'll find it technical and slightly dry in topic. That's why the ulama, they used to say that you have to switch between studying fiqh and studying raqa'iq, that which softens the heart. Because fiqh, by its nature, is a bit dry and technical. So the reason I say this as a prelude is that you need to have the commitment within yourself to benefit. Don't just come for one or two lessons and then leave. Try to stick and see it through. And that's where you will find the benefit by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In any case, let's continue. The author of this text of Zad al-Mustaqnia, Sharafuddin Abu Najah Musa ibn Ahmad al-Hajjawi al-Maqdisi. He died 960 Hijri. Sharafuddin Abu Najah Musa ibn Ahmad al-Hajjawi al-Maqdisi is one of the later scholars of the Hanbali Madhab and one of the Imams of Ahlul Sunnah. His status in the Madhab and outside of the Madhab is a very important one. And this book also has a very significant place amongst the Hanabila. It has many explanations and is taught in a variety of places. In fact, in Saudi Arabia, for example, before you can become a judge, you have to study this book intricately. And if you study this book intricately, then you are considered to have qualified with other, of course, things that you need to study as a Sharia judge. So the text itself is a very important text. And it has many explanations. The most famous of them probably is Rawd al-Murbi' by Imam al-Bahuti. Rawd al-Murbi' by Imam al-Bahuti. Now, the introduction that I've taken is from the explanation of Sheikh Hamad al-Hamad of his explanation of this matan Zad al-Mustaqnia. He mentions what are the benefits of studying a matan in a madhab. He says one of the benefits, which is very clear and evident, is that it's very well organized. The matan is well organized as compared to going to a book of a hadith pertaining to the ahkam, pertaining to the rulings of the Sharia, which are kind of not organized consistently from topic to topic. You will find that the rules and the regulations may be all over the place. So it's difficult for you as a student to concentrate and to regulate your journey in learning. So studying a text in a madhab is clearer, it's more better organized. And you find that, for example, the famous book of hadith pertaining to ahkam, Bulugh al-Maram, written by who? Who is Bulugh al-Maram written by? Or collected by? Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, right? It's a famous book on hadith pertaining to ahkam. So this book was written along the lines of a text in a madhab. It followed the same pattern, okay? So it shows you the importance of that. Another thing that Sheikh Hamad, he mentions with regards to the benefits is that when you study a text, the ulama that have written these texts, they not only give you the rulings, they give you extra information pertaining to the ruling. For example, they will mention to you the conditions of that particular ruling, the shurut. And they will mention to you the restrictions, the quyud. And all of this gives you a better, holistic understanding of what is being spoken about as pertaining to the issue that you are trying to learn. It becomes more holistic for you. And that's why the ulama, they said, al-hukm ala shay far'un min tasawwarihi. Al-hukm ala shay far'un min tasawwarihi. That for a person to give a ruling on a matter, he first needs to have a complete understanding holistically of that matter, but understanding what are the conditions of that matter, what are the rules pertaining to it, what are all of the evidences, and generally you find that's how the matan or a matan gives you the information. And of course, as we know, most of the great imams of Ahlul Sunnah, they studied texts in the madhahib. They went step by step and they learned the fundamentals that are taught through these texts. Like Ibn Taymiyyah, these famous imams, and many others. They all came through the study of these texts. Not this one particularly, but texts which are similar to it in the madhahib. And the ulama, they said, من حرم الوصول حرم الوصول من حرم الوصول حرم الوصول. That whoever is forbidden or whoever does not get hold of the foundation knowledge, then he will be prevented from reaching. He'll be prevented from reaching the end goal, which is to have a solid understanding of the fiqh. So if you are forbidden from the early stages which are found in these texts, then there's no way you can get to the higher stages, as we will come to know more and more. Now, many of you, you have the text which has been translated so far, because there's a lot more to translate, but every few weeks I'll be increasing the amount of the text which is translated and I'll send it out to you. What I forgot to put on the text was the first statement of the Imam's text, where he said, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Yours, I believe, starts from Alhamdulillah. So the first thing that the Imam, he said in this text, Zad al-Mustaqnia, okay, he said, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Why did he start with the Bismillah, the Basmala? Why do you think? Did he just decide, like, you know, it feels good, let's start with the Basmala? What was the reason, do you think? So start with the name of Allah, because this is the way which is the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it's the way of the Quran, that it starts with the Basmala, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his correspondence to whoever he would be communicating with, he would start with the Basmala. For example, in Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, min Muhammad Abdullah ila Azim al-Rum ila Harqal Azim al-Rum. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wrote to Harqal, for example, he started his letter with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So it's something that is found in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as we will come to know, it's something which is extremely important and beneficial to do. Bismillah, this word, the ba in the Bismillah, the basmala, the ba, they call it the ulama ba'ul isti'ana wa ba'ul tabarruk. The ba of isti'ana, which is the ba of seeking aid from Allah Azza wa Jal. And the ba of tabarruk, the ba of having barakah and blessings. So as we said, the ba, it is named the ba of isti'ana. That when you say bismillah, you're saying, oh Allah, I seek your aid and I seek barakah from you in this action which I'm about to do. So the author here, he seeks the aid, or he sought the aid of Allah Azza wa Jal and barakah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in authoring this text, in authoring this book. Ar-Rahman is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pertaining to the great mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has. It's a sifatul dhatiyah. Sifatul dhatiyah means that it's a part of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman, the ever merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahim has the same meaning of excessive amount of mercy, and the difference here is that this is sifa al-fi'liyah, meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala acts in a merciful manner towards his creation. Tayyib, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The author, Abu Musa al-Hajjawi, he said, Alhamdulillahi hamdan la yanfad. Alhamd means that a person praises and mentions the good qualities of the one that he is praising. A person praises and mentions the good qualities of the one that he's praising. So of course, when you praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are remembering the perfect qualities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, and how beautiful and majestic Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And generally, when a person thinks of hamd, alhamdulillah, he thinks of that as a form of shukr. And that is one of the meanings of hamd, that it contains the meaning of shukr, that when somebody gives you something, you praise them. When Allah gives you something, you praise Him. But with regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is above and beyond that. Because whether Allah gives or He doesn't give to you, you still praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take the example of a person who is known to be kind, generous, brave, etc., etc. That person is embodied with so many good qualities that even though you don't know the person per se, individually, but you hear of the person, you would praise that person. That so-and-so is known to be generous, so-and-so is known to be brave. So even though you're not receiving for that person, you will still praise that person. And to Allah Azza wa Jalla belongs the highest example. Even if it were to be the case, which is never the case, because everybody receives in every single moment from Allah Azza wa Jalla, so we need to be thanking Allah every moment. But if it was the case that you didn't receive from Allah, you would still praise Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because He's deserving of praise. Because He's beautiful and perfect and majestic, subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Ibn Majah, it's narrated that the Prophet ﷺ, كَانَ إِذَا رَأَى مَا يُحِبْ قَالَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي بِنِعْمَتِهِ تَتِمُّ الصَّالِحَاتِ. That the Prophet ﷺ, as narrated Ibn Majah, it would be narrated about him that whenever he would see something that pleased him, he would say, praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with whose favor these bounties are given and perfected. وَإِذَا رَأَى مَا يَكْرَهُ قَالَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ عَلَى كُلِّ حَالٍ. And if the Prophet ﷺ saw that which displeased him, he would say, praise be to Allah in all situations. So this is the situation of the righteous slave, that he praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all of his situations. The Imam, the author, he said, حَمْدًا لَا يَنْفَدْ. What does that mean? What did you have written in your notes there? So that you're staying with me. Okay, a praise that never ends. A praise that never ends. What does this mean? The one who's praising Allah Azza wa Jal, does his praise never end? At times, the one who's praising, his praise will end. Maybe he will get busy, so he forgets to praise Allah Azza wa Jal. Maybe he will pass away, so there's no more praise from him. But as we said, even if none of the creation are praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah Azza wa Jal is praised because He's deserving of praise. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if me and you are not praising Him, then Allah Azza wa Jal has countless number of creation that praise Him. As Allah mentioned in Surah Al-Isra, وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ. And there's nothing except that it praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah Azza wa Jal, He's praised continually and by everything in creation subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next thing that the author mentions, he says, وَصَلَّ. When you say sallallahu, you are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send salah upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what did this salah mean? When you send salah upon Muhammad sallallahu ala Muhammad in any of its forms, you are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to mention the virtues, characteristics, to make thana upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi mala'il a'la. To make thana upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the highest of gatherings, amongst the angels and those with whom are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the meaning of sallallahu, okay? As collected by Imam Abu Aliya, mentioned by Imam Abu Aliya, rahimullah ta'ala, and collected by Imam Bukhari. And when you say wasallim, it comes from the word salama, which means peace and tranquility and safety. So when you say sallallahu alayhi wa sallim, when you say the part which says sallim, you are asking Allah Azza wa Jal, after mentioning the praise of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from all types of harm and all types of shortcomings that may befall him, whether in life or after life. And then you say, the Imam, he said, the author, he said, ala afdalil mustafain, upon the best of the Mustafain. The Mustafain are those messengers who are the messengers and prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it means in English that this salah should be upon the best of the chosen ones. And the chosen ones are who? The prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who are the best from amongst the messengers and the prophets? You can't whisper to me, I'm a bit deaf, you have to shout. Huh? I can't hear you, bro. What's he saying? Who are the best from amongst the prophets? Okay. Ah, so I want in plural. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ahsant, you're correct. He's the best of all of the prophets. But who are the best? There's a group of them. Ulul Azm, and who are they? Huh? Aywa? Mm-hmm. Ahsant. And the Prophet ﷺ is the best from amongst them, okay? So when we are sending salah upon after al-Mustafain, this is what it means, to send salah upon the prophets and messengers, and in particular the Ulul Azm, and from them, the best of them is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَصَلَّ اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ عَلَى الْأَفْضَلِ الْمُصْطَفَيْنِ Muhammad. Muhammad, the well-known name of this blessed Prophet of ours, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad is ismul maf'ul ala al-wazn mufa'al. Okay, if you understand that Arabic, then good, alhamdulillah. If not, then Muhammad in Arabic is upon the scale. In Arabic, words and verbs, they have scales and patterns. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fits upon the scale of mufa'al. And mufa'al, it has the meaning of tikrar. Okay, or meaning of repetition. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one who is praised repeatedly. Is this the case? Is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praised repeatedly? In all of the time zones, whenever the adhan is called, the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioned. Whenever the people pray, they mention the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In so many places, the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is mentioned, and rightfully so. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. O Muhammad, we have ensured that your name will be made high and remembered often. And this is the reality of the situation. What's the other famous name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That's his kunya. Ahmed, the one who praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most. So you have Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one that is praised the most or praised often, and then Ahmed, the one who is the most praising of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than any other of his creation. So the Imam, the author, he said, وَصَلَّ wa sallam ala أَفْضَلِ الْمُصْطَفَيْنِ Muhammad وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ. And also the salah is upon the al of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al comes from ala ya'ulu. Ala ya'ulu means to return. To return to a person, okay, in terms of nasab, in terms of lineage. Okay, so the al is that which returns to a person in terms of his lineage. And here, of course, the al is used in two ways. Ma'na al-am wa ma'na khas. Okay? Next time, I hope you've understood that you have to bring your pencils and your notepads. Otherwise, much of this stuff, unless you are like Imam Shafi, you memorize everything you see in here, it's just going to go over your head. By the time you leave the door, you'll even forget your name, right? Because there's so much things you're hearing. So al, it's used in two ways. Am, which is a general meaning, and khas, which is a specific meaning. Am, the general meaning, means for anybody who follows Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, anybody who believes in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and follows him. The specific meaning of al is referring to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's close family and relatives. Okay, so these are the two meanings of al, the two usages. And then the Imam, the author, he says, wa ashabihi, and the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May the salah be upon the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who is a companion? Who is a sahabi? Define a sahabi for me with your nice loud voice. No, you're giving me the name of a sahabi. I want the definition. Excellent. Good. Somebody who accepted Islam whilst he was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now the brother said he's missing a part of the definition. While he was with him, yeah, we can say met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Good, with the Prophet and met the Prophet, accepted Islam, right? And he died Muslim. Okay, man laqiya an-nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam mu'minan bihi wa mata ala dhalik. Whoever met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was believing in him and then died upon that belief. That is the definition of a companion, right? So if somebody met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam whilst the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was alive, of course, because he met him. And then the person left Islam, but then came back to Islam. Is this person a sahabi? If the Prophet was alive, right? But let's say the Prophet ﷺ passed away. Is he still a sahabi? So the person met the Prophet ﷺ whilst he was alive and he believed in him. And then the person left Islam. and the Prophet ﷺ passed away to solve your issue. And then the man came back to Islam. Is this person a Sahabi? Yes. Okay, the person is still a Sahabi because he's going to die on Islam. That's the important thing, right? He's going to die on Islam, right? A person met the Prophet ﷺ but didn't believe in him. But later on, after the Prophet ﷺ died, the person believed in him. Is he a Sahabi? What is he considered? Huh? Tabi, right? He's considered a Tabi. طيب. So we just said a Sahabi, man laqiya Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mu'minan bihi wa mata ala dhalik. Whoever met the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam believing in him and then died upon that belief. The next thing that the author says after sending salah upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and upon his family and upon his companions, he said, wa man ta'abbad. And whoever worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon tawheed, then these people, salah is also deserving upon them. So anybody who worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then the author is sending salah upon them. What is worship? What is worship? We're studying a course in worship, inshallah. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, he gave a good definition. He said, worship is ismun jam'un lima yuhibbuhu Allahu wa yardahu min al-aqwal wal-af'al al-zahira wal-batina. He said that worship, al-ibadah, is a comprehensive noun, ismun jami'a, lima yuhibbuhu Allah wa yardahu, for that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves and is pleased with, from actions and statements which are either apparent or hidden. Okay? So if it pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah loves it, whether it's an outward action or an inward action of the heart, then it's considered to be worship. How do you know if Allah is pleased with something as being an act of worship? Pardon? No. How do you know if Allah is pleased with something being an act of worship? Afwan? Excellent. It's found in the Quran and the Sunnah, okay, authentically upon the narrations and the understandings of the companions radiallahu anhum. طيب. That's how we know, okay, that something is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the author, he said, amma ba'd. Amma ba'd is used to say after what has preceded. As for what has preceded, we are now entering, it's used for entering into the topic. Okay, so anything after that, amma ba'd, anything after that which we have spoken about, and it's used to enter into the topic, which is the topic of discussion, amma ba'd. So before, everything which we mentioned to now was just the author's praising of Allah Azza wa Jal and sending salah upon the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, his family and all those who deserve that. So the Imam, he mentions, amma ba'd, fahada mukhtasar fil fiqh. He says, as for what follows, this is a mukhtasar. Mukhtasar means a summary. And is that which has few words, but kathratul ma'ani. Its words are few, but its meanings are much. So a summary, when the ulama mention mukhtasar, they mean that which is summarized in terms of the words being less, but the meanings are many. Okay? Al-mukhtasar fil fiqh. So this is a summary in fiqh. What is the meaning of fiqh? What does fiqh mean linguistically? I can hear whisperings. Huh? Ahsant, understanding, right? Because Musa alayhi salam, he made dua to Allah azza wa jal, wahlul uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Yafqahu, the same verb, the same meaning or derivative of fiqh, right? He made dua to Allah, take away the knots in my tongue so that my speech could be understood. So fiqh linguistically means understanding, right? Linguistically, what does fiqh mean? Understanding. Technically, it means istilahan ma'rifatu al-ahkam al-shar'iyyati al-taklifiyya al-amaliyya min adillatiha al-tafsiliyya. It means knowing the rules of the sharia, having knowledge of the rules of the sharia that are upon a person to conform to. And they are actions, not aqa'id, not beliefs in the heart, rather they are actions. And they are taken from detailed evidences, right? Detailed evidences meaning the hadith, the Quran, the qiyas, etc. معرفة الأحكام الشرعية التكليفية العملية من أدلتها التفصيلية. The knowledge of rules of Sharia that are upon a person to conform to, and they are actions, not aqaid, detailed evidences, meaning from the Quran, the Sunnah, the Ijma, etc. The Imam, he said, هذا مقتصر في الفقه. This is a summary of fiqh. من مقنع الإمام موافق أبي محمد. Where did this summary come from? This is very important because it will make you understand the value of the text that you are studying. This summary came from a book written by the great Imam Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi rahimullah ta'ala, whose book we studied previously, the chapters of Ibadat, Umdatul Fiqh, right? Those of you who were with us before, we studied his book and we know the status of this great Imam. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimullah ta'ala said about him, مَا دَخَلَ شَامٍ بَعْدَ أَوْزَائِي أَفْقَهُ مِنْ Ibn Taymiyyah. That nobody entered into the lands of Sham after Imam Awza'i more knowledgeable than Imam Ibn Taymiyyah. And there's many statements of many ulama, of Imam Ibn Qudama, not Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah was the one who's writing this statement. There's many statements of the scholars pertaining to Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi rahimahullah ta'ala, a well-known Imam of Ahl Sunnah and a well-known Imam of the Madhab of the Hanabila. He's called the Sheikh of the Madhab. And he's called Sheikh al-Islam. So this muqtasar, this summary which is being written by the author, okay, al-Hajjawi, he summarized it from one of the books written by Imam Ibn Qudama. The book is called Muqni' al-Muqni'. Ibn Qudama, he wrote a syllabus for studying fiqh. He wrote a syllabus that many hundreds of years ago before anybody else thought about writing syllabuses for education. Imam Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi wrote one. It comprises of four books. The first of them is Umdat al-Fiqh. In Umda, the Imam, he mentions one relied upon opinion of the Madhab, of the Hanbali Madhab, right? Without any differences of opinions or anything of that nature. And he mentioned in it a few ahadith and a few verses from the Quran to prove his points, to get the talib al-ilm, to get the student of knowledge a little bit used to seeing where the evidences come from, right? The second book is this book, Al-Muqni, which Al-Hajjawi summarized into Zad al-Mustaqnia, okay? Al-Muqni, Ibn Qudama, he mentioned two opinions of the Madhab, but he didn't mention any of the Adilla or the Ta'lilat. He didn't mention any of the evidences or the reasonings. In the third book that Imam Ibn Qudama mentioned, he wrote Al-Kafi, the Sufficer, Al-Kafi. In Al-Kafi, Imam Ibn Qudama basically stuck to what was in Al-Muqni', except that now he brought about the evidences and the reasonings. So that student of knowledge, after having a solid foundation from the previous two books, can now look into detailed evidences as to where these points came from. The fourth book that Imam Ibn Qudama wrote was the encyclopedia of fiqh known as Al-Mughni. It's said that Imam Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he wrote his amazing encyclopedia of fiqh, Al-Majmu', based upon this book, Al-Mughni. That Imam Nawawi was so impressed by Ibn Qudama's encyclopedia Al-Mughni that he wrote his book also, Al-Majmu', according to it. In Al-Mughni, Ibn Qudama rahimahullah ta'ala, he went through every single fiqh issue and he compared it through all the madhahib. Through all the madhahib that are known, he compared it. He looked at the evidences and he gave what he felt to be the strongest from those evidences, right? So it's an encyclopedia of fiqh. So he wrote this curriculum with tadarruj. Tadarruj meaning step by step. Why? Because the ulama, they said, man rama ilm jumlatan, dhahaba anhu jumlatan. Whoever takes knowledge in one go, then it will leave him in one go. So most of us, when we try to do fiqh, we start from al-mughni, deluding ourselves, delusional, thinking that we can understand what's going on, right? People like to do that. When they study fiqh, yeah, I read that book, or I held that opinion because it came from there. You really don't know what you're talking about, you're just parroting what you've read somewhere or what somebody has said to you, right? In order to understand al-mughni and to be able to navigate it, you have to have had years and years of deep study, okay? In many sciences of Islam. So the point is, where did Imam al-Hajjawi bring this summary from that he's bringing? He brought it from Al-Muqni, which was the second book in the curriculum written by Imam Muwaffaq ad-Din Ibn Qudama al-Maqdisi. Okay? The Imam, he says, the author, Al-Hajjawi, he says, وَرُبَّمَا حَذَفْتُ مِنْهُ مَسَائِلًا نَادِرَةَ الْوَقُوِي وَزِدْتُمَا عَلَى مِثْلِهِ يُعْتَمَدُ. He said, I took out some issues from Muqni, the book of Ibn Qudama, when I was summarizing it. Why did I take out some of these issues? نَادِرَةَ الْوَقُوِي, because I don't find them in my time, which is about 300 or so years after the time of Ibn Qudama. I don't find them prevalent in my time anymore. So he took these issues out. وَزِدْتُمَا عَلَى مِثْلِهِ يُعْتَمِدُ, and I increased some issues which I found that people need to rely upon. That now, in my time, people need to know these issues and they don't need to know other issues. What did this tell you about the Imam and the author? It tells you that the scholars, the righteous amongst them, they don't write books for the sake of becoming known. They don't write books for the sake of just wanting to write. They write books for the sake of serving the religion and serving the Ummah. That is the purpose behind these great Imams and these great authors. They spend their lives and their time preserving the religion for the sake of us, that we can come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Imam, he said, where are we so far? إِذْ أَلْحِمَمُ قَدْ قَصُرَتْ. And the reason he's saying, I summarized apart from the two things he just mentioned, is that the himam, the motivation of people, the motivation of people and the determination of people has lessened. Okay, in his time he's talking about. وَالْأَسْبَابُ مُثَبِّتَةُ عَنِ النَّيْلِ الْمُرَادِ قَدْ كَثُرَتْ. And the things which cause people or keep people away from seeking this virtuous knowledge has increased. He's talking about his time, right? 900 Hijri. Imagine our time today. And one of the greatest things which keeps a person away from seeking or benefiting from knowledge, are sins, as the ulama mentioned. And wherever we look today, wherever we look, wherever we sit, there's sins. Imam al-Shafi rahimullah ta'ala, his memory was so strong that wherever he looked at, he would memorize. He would have to cover one side of the page so he wouldn't confuse what he's memorizing. One day, he happened to be walking and he looked upon the ankle of a woman. The ankle, the foot of a woman. Not intentionally. The wind had blown up her dress slightly. And he found that after having looked upon the ankle, he couldn't memorize the way he used to. So he complained to his teacher, Waqi. He said, Shakawtu ila Waqi'i su'a hifdi. He said, I complained to my teacher the poorness of my memory. فَأَرْشَدَنِي إِلَى تَرْكَ الْمَعَاصِي. So my teacher Waqi guided me to leave alone sins. SubhanAllah. وَأَخْبَرَنِي بَأَنَّ عِلْمَ النُّورِ. And he told me that verily knowledge is light. وَنُورَ اللَّهِ لَا يُهْدَى لِعَاصِي. And the light of Allah Azawajal is not gifted to the one who is sinful. So we have to bear that in mind when we try to come close to Allah Azawajal through learning. The Imam, he says after that, أما بعد فهذا مقتصر في الفقه من مقن الإمام موافق أبي محمد على قول واحد. نعم. So this مقتصر, this summary that we spoke about in fiqh, it's upon قول واحد. It's upon one relied upon opinion, which according to the Imam is the mashhur, the famous opinion in the madhab. Okay. So if you want to know what is the famous opinion in the madhab, you have to look to this text, and this text will give us that, inshallah. وهو الراجح في المذهب أحمد. And it is the relied upon opinion in the madhab of Imam Ahmed. طيب. That is one of the things that I missed in the earlier statement. The next thing the Imam, he says, and we'll stop with the last, with this part inshallah, is that he says, وَمَعَ صِغْرِ حَجْمِهِ حَوَى مَا يُغْنِي أَنِ التَّطْوِيلِ. He's talking about his summary, that he's still talking about the summary that he made, right? He said, even though it's been summarized and it's small, he says, it suffices one having to go to those books which are very long. What does he mean by this? Some of the ulama, they said that in this Zad al-Mustaqnia, there are over 3,000 masail. 3,000 masail, 3,000 issues are spoken about in this book. And others amongst them, they said, if you consider that which is mantuq and mafhum, mantuq meaning that which is specifically written, and the mafhum that which is deduced, then you will have around 6,000 masail. So though the text is quite small, it contains so much. Due to the barakah of the knowledge that the Imam had, he was able to summarize the book Al-Muqni of Imam Ibn Qudama, and he was able to put it in such a way that it's small in size, yet it has so much in terms of meaning. And then he says, وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. He said, there is no حَوْل. حَوْل means that there is no movement except by the permission of Allah Azza wa Jal. So one does not move from the state of shirk to tawheed except with the permission of Allah. One does not move from the state of being in sin to obedience except with the permission of Allah. One does not move from being ignorant to having knowledge except with the permission of Allah Azza wa Jal. And la quwwa means that there is no power except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa qawl huwa hasbuna. And then the Imam, he says, huwa hasbuna. Allah Azza wa Jal is hasbuna. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ayyuhan nabi hasbukallah. O Prophet of Allah, Allah is sufficient for you. Allah is sufficient for you. And this is the statement of the righteous through all times. Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil. Ni'mal wakil, the one who is best to rely upon and the one who is best to dispose our affairs. The Imam, he mentions now, Kitab al-Tahara. Kitab al-Tahara. The book of purification. So now we're actually delving into the text and the thing that we want to study. Kitab al-Tahara. Kitab comes from the word in Arabic, takattub. It has the meaning of takattub. Takattub, takattaba banu falan idha ijtama'u. Takattab, the people, it says takattaba banu falan idha ijtama'u, meaning the people got together, they gathered together. So this word takattub, from where kitab is taken, it has the meaning of gathering. Okay? Yuqal li jama'atul jaysh, katibatul jaysh. Okay? It said when there is a gathering of soldiers, katiba. Kitab, katiba, close in meaning, right? And here, what it means is that there is a gathering of a variety of different pieces of knowledge, tahta musamma wahid, under one name. So it's a gathering of a variety of different pieces of knowledge under one name, which is Kitab al-Tahara. The Hanbali scholars, when they talk about, when they put their matun, their text together, they follow the tartib. Tartib means the order, the sequence of the hadith of Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Bunya al-Islam wa la khams. That Islam is built upon five. Shahadati an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammad rasulullah. Wa iqami salah, wa ita'i zakah, wa al-hajj, wa salmi ramadan. This is the order that the Hanbali scholars, they follow when it comes to acts of worship, right? So what was the first act of worship mentioned in the hadith? Huh? After the testimony of faith? I can't hear you, brothers. Establishing the prayer, excellent. Then why, and I'm telling you that the Hanbali scholars, they follow the order which is in the hadith, then why is this author following, then why is this author starting with purification, not salah? It's a condition of the prayer, right? So tahara is a shart for the condition for the prayer, and the shart muqaddam ala al-mashrut. The condition always comes before that which it is a condition for. طيب. And the Prophet ﷺ said, as collected by Imam Ahmed, miftahu salah al-tahur. The key to the prayer is tahur. So in order for us to pray, we need to have purification, tahur. The author mentions in this chapter pertaining to purification, 15 masail, okay? In the Bab al-Miyah, the first of the chapters in the book of purification is going to be the book pertaining to water. And he will mention 15 masail. Masail is the word plural for mas'ala. Mas'ala comes from that su'al, the thing which is asked about often. The thing which is asked about often becomes a mas'ala, that which is then researched by the ulama, and it becomes an issue in fiqh, okay? So when we say masail and mas'ala, it comes from that which is asked about and researched often. The Imam, he says, defining what is tahara, he says here, irtifa'u al-hadith wa ma fi ma'nahu wa zawalu al-khabath. Irtifa'u al-hadith, the raising of hadith and the removal of impurities. So the author, he defines tahara. That's the definition of tahara. We're going to break it down step by step, inshallah. Irtifa' al-hadith wa ma fi ma'nahu wa zawal al-khabith. As for the word itself, tahara, tahara means an-nadhafa anil-akhdar. That nadhafa from that which is impure. Nadhafa meaning cleanliness. So tahara, when you hear the word tahara, it means cleanliness from any type of filth. Cleanliness, right? And tahara is of two types. Taharatul ma'nawi and taharatul hissi. Tahara al-Ma'nawi, meaning Tahara purification, which is intangible. Intangible meaning something you cannot see or touch. Okay? So this Tahara al-Ma'nawi, intangible purification, is related to spiritual purification. Like Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْمُشْرِكُونَ نَجَسْ. O you who believe, verily, the polytheists, they are najis, they are impure. Are they impure when you touch them? Can you wrestle with them? Can you do BJJ with them? Yes, you can. The impurity is referring to the spiritual impurity, right? So tahara is of two types, we are saying. Purification, that which is ma'nawi, tahara al-ma'nawi, intangible purification, and tahara al-hissi, and tahara which is tangible. Jazakallahu khair, ahsanallahu ilayk, thank you. Tahara which is tangible, okay? So tahara which is tangible, for example, a person breaks his wudu, he goes to the bathroom, relieves himself. So this person now is in a state of hadith. He needs to remove that hadith. He needs to make tahara to remove that. So the statement of the imam comprises how many components? Can you see there? Irtifa' al-hadith, that's the first one. وَمَا فِي مَعْنَاهُ وَزَوَالُ الْخَبْثِ. If you look at the statement in front of you, it comprises three parts. Irtifa' al-hadith, raising of hadith. What is this thing, hadith? Hadith, the ulama, they say, hadith is wasfun ma'nawi yaqumu bil badan yamna'u min as-salah wa nahwiha mimma yashtaritu lahu at-tahara. Wasfun ma'nawi, it is a intangible description. Okay, yaqumu fil badan, found upon the person. Not physically, you can't see it physically, it's intangible. But it's a description given to this person, right? It prevents him from praying the salah. يَمْنَعُ مِنَ الصَّلَاةِ وَنَحْوِهَا مِمَّا يَشْتَرِطُ لَهُ الطَّهَارَةِ. It prevents the person from praying the salah or other acts of worship for which tahara is conditioned for. This is the definition that the ulama give. Tahara, hadith, right? So what is hadith? It's a description which is found in a person. It prevents the person from praying and doing other acts of worship which are wherein tahara is required, right? So when we say hadith, this is what we mean. Hadith is of two types. The hadith which is big, hadith al-akbar, and the hadith which is small, hadith al-asghar. Hadith which is big, how do you purify yourself from that? The big hadith. You need to do ghusl, okay? Hadith al-akbar, in order to remove that from yourself, you need to make ghusl. Hadith al-asghar are those things which wudu is required for. The smaller hadith is those things which wudu is required for. Tayyib. So we know now what hadith is, right? It's a description, intangible description. No, that was when I was referring to tahara. Tahara. But now hadith itself is what is wasful ma'na, you can't see it. It's just a description given to the person. Right? This is what they mean by it. Tayyib. So it's wasful ma'nawi, okay, that prevents a person from praying, etc. Okay? What was the second part of the definition? He said irtifa'ul hadith, removing the hadith. This is the first definition of what purification is, the first part of the definition. The second part from amongst the three parts is, tell me. وَمَا فِي مَعْنَاهُ, matters which are similar to it. Okay? Matters which, if you look at it outwardly, you say that this is also purification, but it's not. Okay? So the ulama, how do they describe this? مَا فِي مَعْنَى إِرْتِفَاعِ الْحَدِثِ. That which is the meaning of raising of hadith, the raising of the hadith, but it's not actually the raising of hadith. They say, الضابط فِي هَذَا كُلُّ طَحَارَةٍ لَا يَرْفَعُ بِهَا حَدِثِ أَوْ يَكُونَ أَوْ لَا يَكُونَ عَنِ الْحَدِثِ. Every tahara, dabit, this word you're going to hear quite often. Dabit is like, in English, the modifier. Modifying the meaning of what we are saying, right? So this, what the imam is mentioning, ما في معناه, okay? And also that which is in the meaning of hadith. That which is in the meaning of purification, of raising of hadith, but it's not. Okay, what he means by this, is every purification which doesn't raise hadith. But when you look at it, it's purification, but it doesn't raise hadith. Or it's a purification done not due to hadith. Okay? So every purification which is not removing the state of hadith, or it's a purification which in of itself is not done to remove hadith. I'll give you some examples which will make this clear, inshallah. So for example, wudu and ghusl, which is mustahab. But when you look at a person making wudu or ghusl, will you say he's making tahara or not? He's purifying or not? Of course you will say he's purifying himself. But is he purifying himself to remove hadith, to remove that state which prevents him from praying? No, because it's a recommended ghusl and it's a recommended wudu. So this is an example of what fits into وَمَا فِي مَعْنَاهُ. Okay, into the second part of the definition. Another example is, they say, the one who has salas al-bawl. Salas al-bawl is the one who his urine drops come continually. What's that called? Anyway, somebody who has salas al-bawl, he continually has urine drops. So this person, he makes wudu, right? But has his hadith gone? Has his impure state gone? He's made wudu, it hasn't gone, right? All that's happened is that he now has the permission to pray, because his situation is a peculiar situation. But the reality of his situation is that his hadith hasn't been raised. His hadith hasn't been lifted. So this is another example. Another example they give is, for example, when you make ghusl of the dead. Are you purifying outwardly? Yes, you're purifying. But are you raising a hadith from the, or are you raising the state of impurity from the person? No, because the dead doesn't have impurity, right? So these are examples of this second part of the definition. The third part, inshallah, and this is what we will finish with. He says, what does he say? Zawalul khabath. Okay, zawalul khabath is the removing of impurities. Okay, the first part was raf al hadith, the raising of the state of hadith, wa ma fi ma'nahu. And the second part was, and that which is similar to the first part. And the third part now is zawalul khabath, removing impurities. Okay, all of this is the definition of tahara. Zawalul khabath, removing of impurities. The word zawal is used instead of raf, the ulama they explain, because it is something that is not requiring an intention, and it's tangible, and it can be done without water. The reason you say zawal al-khabath, removing of the impurities, because number one, it's intangible. Number one, it's tangible. Not like hadith is intangible. It doesn't require intention, and it can be done without water. Whereas hadith, raf al-hadith, the word raf is used with hadith, because it's intangible, it requires an intention, and it requires water. Tayyib. So, zawal al-khabath means to remove impurities. To remove impurities. Impurities, najasa, is of two types. Najasa tu ayniya, najasa which in of itself is impure. What do I mean by that? For example, excrement. Excrement in of itself is impure. No matter what you do to it, it's going to remain impure. Or the second one is najasa at-tari'ah. Najasa at-tari'ah. Najasatu at-tari'atu. Okay? That najasa which comes upon something which is originally pure. For example, you're wearing your thobe and a drop of urine, azakumullah, drops upon this thobe which is originally pure. What can I do with the najasa? I can wash it off. I can take it away. Okay? So we have two types of najasa, two types of impurity. The first of them is ayni, which cannot be changed from its state of being impure. It's always going to remain impure. And then we have the najasa at-tari'a. The najasatu at-tari'atu. That which najasa comes upon something which is originally pure. Okay? The reason I'm giving you these detailed definitions is as we go into the masail, as we go into the things that we're going to talk about, I'll be using these terms. And it will help you to understand what's been explained by the explainers of this text, inshaAllah. So the Imam, he says, Al-Miyah Thalatha. Water is of three categories, and this is where we're going to stop, inshaAllah, and we will continue next week from this point onwards. Where the Imam, he says, water is of three categories. Okay? Wa jazakumullah khair. I ask Allah to make the understanding easy for you and to make the explanation easy for me.